the victory, sister. He has given us the victory by his strong right arm. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord. Well, hallelujah. Give him praise again. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Bless his name forevermore. Oh, hallelujah. I don't think we're finished yet. One more time. One more time. He's worthy of our praise. One more time. A wave of ovation offered to him. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now turn around and hug a neck, or two, or three. I'll tell you what, I was with you once before in camp meeting, but I don't remember you being as crazy as this. Something's happening in Alabama. You've gone stark raving mad. You've gone crazy. Glory. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love him. 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 Oh, hallelujah. I'll tell you what, I have been so concerned about us as a denomination that we were going to miss this move of God. But you are encouraging me. You're as fanatic as any charismatic Baptist or Methodist I've been with recently. I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged. Glory. Hallelujah. You know, we have a colorful history, don't we? We Pentecostals. Did you hear about the Pentecostals in a Brush Arbor meeting? Got so excited, took off running. Ran out of the Brush Arbor, still full of energy. Thought he'd climb a tree. Climbed all the way to the top of the tree and then realized he had climbed a thorn tree and got to the top of it without a scratch on, and the Spirit left him and he had to get down by himself. Did you hear about the Baptists and Methodists talking to one another, and they said, do you honestly think there are going to be any Pentecostals in heaven? One of them looked at the other and said, you know what? I used to didn't think those fanatics were going to go, but I honestly believe they love Jesus. If they don't run right past the pearly gates and miss it, I think we'll find some of them there. I heard about an Episcopalian who came to one of our services, and it was hopping about like it was here tonight. He turned around and looked at a Pentecostal. He said, don't you know God's not deaf? They looked at him and said, he ain't nervous either. We have a colorful history. Somewhere along the way, we seem to have gotten a little embarrassed about our zeal, One of the men recently in one of the summits, prayer summits that I'm involved in, these interdenominational pastors' prayer enclaves, said, you know, the strange thing about it is that we mainline denominations are now trying to get the Spirit, and you folks are trying to become like us. There's certainly some issues in 1 Corinthians 14 regarding order and propriety and worship that we sometimes have read past. But given the need, granted the need for balance in worship, if we lose our Pentecostal passion, we have lost the very reason God raised up this movement. I use the term movement because in the early days, we were a movement. The old timers used to talk about how's the movement going. We were a movement. We saw ourselves as being raised up in the destiny of last days eschatology to restore primitive Christianity. We saw ourselves as destined to bring back the apostolic dimension to the church. We called ourselves the Christian Union. Our purpose was to pollinate every denomination with the blessed Holy Spirit and renewal, fire, and fervor. Somewhere along the way, we settled for being a denomination and we stopped being a movement. But Pentecost has always been a movement. At the turn of the century, there were a handful of us. Now there are 470 million. Harvey Cox, a liberal Harvard theologian, in his book Fire from Heaven, says this movement is unstoppable. Where other churches have dried up, this movement is flourishing. In the inner city, where other churches can't survive, these churches are not only surviving, they are thriving. Pentecost has been able to contextualize itself in every culture around the world and become a thoroughly indigenous movement. Harvey Cox says, though they were non-existent a century ago, in another 25 years, there will be 1.2 billion Pentecostals in the world, the largest force in Christendom. This is our finest hour. This is our day. God has brought us to this moment. And we cannot forget what He has called us to do and what He has called us to be. Last night, I talked about the mystery of prayer. Tonight, I want to talk about the mystery of intimacy with God. It is, to me, a mystery that while God calls us to do, the gateway to doing is always found in being. While God calls us to work, the gateway to doing the work of God is always found in worship. While we seek to see His hand move with might, His hand moves with might only when we seek not His hand, but His face. This is the mystery of God's ways, the mystery of intimacy with God. I want to take you on a journey tonight through the Song of Solomon. Turn in your Bible to the Song of Solomon. And I want to show you five features of relationship
that I think are important to us, and then three movements in this. Now, I'm well aware that the Song of Solomon is written as a discourse on the bliss of marital love. But I'm also aware that you really can't separate your relationship from your spouse and your relationship with Christ. Is that right? Paul talks about husbands loving their wives and wives living in cooperative submission to their husbands. And then when he gets to the end of that chapter, he says, this is a real mystery. What I'm really talking about is Christ and the church. Well, wait a minute. I thought you were talking about husbands and wives. Well, I really am talking about husbands and wives and Christ and the church, because you can't separate your passion in marriage from your passion in your relationship to God. We need passionate marriages, and we also need a passionate faith. Somebody said, marriage begins with a prince kissing an angel and ends up with a bald-headed man sitting in a room with a fat lady. Not talking about you now. Somebody said, we start off thinking we got the ideal. Pretty soon we think we got a raw deal, and then we start looking for a new deal. Hear about the couple been married for 50 years. She had never seen him cry. He's so stoic. 50th anniversary, he's sitting there with a tear streaming down his face. She looked over and said, Henry, I've never seen you cry. Could you for once, after 50 years, share your emotions with me? Tell me what you're feeling. He cleared his throat and said, you really want to know? She said, yes. He said, I was just thinking, it's 50 years ago today that your daddy found us in the hayloft and pulled us out. I can still feel the cold steel of his shotgun barrel in my ribs. And I remember him looking at me and saying, boy, I've got connections in this county, and you can marry her or I'll put you away for 50 years. He said, I was just thinking that today I could have been a free man. Glory. We need a passionate marriage, and we need passion in our relationship with Christ. Let me walk you through the Song of Solomon. Now, I'm a teacher. Somebody came to me last night and said, you know, said that wasn't half bad. Said, if a real evangelist had had those notes, we could have really jacked this thing up and gone with it last night. You know, us Bible teachers, we don't get any respect, do we, Don? We ought to start a Bible teachers union. You know, normally they take the night speaker out for dinner after you preach your heart out. Last night, every one of them left and went somewhere else. Because if you are a morning guy in a nighttime spot, you don't get to go out and eat afterwards, see? You see, just a morning guy in a nighttime spot, you don't get to go out. So I'm just a Bible, turn around and look at somebody and say, he's just a Bible teacher, really pray. He's just a Bible teacher. All right? Notice what he says here. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. Now, I'm going to be very deliberate as I work my way through this passage. Here is passion. Thy love, he says, is better than wine. Love is likened here to wine. It makes you dizzy, lightheaded, woozy. You can't think straight. You say, I do, and other crazy things. You promise your life away. You sign things that get put under your nose later. You're drunk. You're intoxicated. Love sweeps you off your feet. She said, his kisses are like wine. They are intoxicating. Now, this thing of intoxication. And our relationship with God is something we Pentecostals are familiar with. Because when the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, they said, these men are just drunk with wine. Peter said, it's just 9 o'clock in the morning. We hadn't had time to get drunk. What are you talking about? This is that was spoken by the prophet Joel. I'll pour out my spirit. We are not drunk like you think, but we are intoxicated. We are under the spell of a power and a spirit, and we're as lightheaded as you can get. We're filled with the Holy Spirit. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself. You know, psychologists say you shouldn't talk to yourself, but the Bible says talk to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make melody in your heart to the Lord. We need the kind of relationship with God that makes us intoxicated, lost in His presence. You know, Hannah was a godly woman, but she was barren. Read it carefully, 1 Samuel chapter 1, and you'll discover that her husband brought home another woman. Now, I don't know what would happen at your house if you brought home another woman. My wife is so gracious. She would say, Penny, Penina was her name, I'll call her Penny. So nice to have you. And then she'd look at me and say, what are her bags doing here? There'd be a few more questions, there'd be a couple short explanations, followed by a double homicide, and I would be the first victim. It wouldn't work at my place. But Elkanah, her husband, brought home another woman. The Bible speaks of sons, plural, that's two, and daughters, plural, that's two. And Hannah is living in the misery of this experience. You talk about rejection, you talk about pain, you talk about hurt, you talk about frustration, you talk about feeling like you're in a box canyon. You talk about having a big fat zero posted on you. You talk about feeling like you are a daughter of Belial. Literally, it means I am a daughter of worthlessness. That's exactly where Hannah was. You know, there's one thing you can do when you're backed in a corner like that. You can let bitterness grip you, or you can decide you're going to do like Hannah. She made her way to the tabernacle of the Lord. And the Bible says, the Bible indicates that she prayed. She poured her soul out to God. She reached a place in God where she moved from this level to that level, where the world on top of this world became more real to her. The things that you can touch with natural hands, all of a sudden the Bible said her lips were moving, but nothing was coming out. Eli says, you're drunk. Oh no, sir, brother high priest, I haven't tasted anything. I'm barren, and I poured my soul out to the Lord. I just got lost in the Spirit of the Lord. I got lost in the Holy Ghost. I got lost in the presence of God. That's what happened to me. Eli looked at her and said, you're gonna have a baby. That's what you're. Hannah moved from barrenness to fruitfulness. Micah, Saul's daughter, and David's wife saw the ark coming back into town. And David was dancing wildly in the streets. She was bothered by it. It was beneath his dignity. Not only was he dancing wildly, he had stripped off his kingly, ornate robes and was dancing as a commoner to show total humility before the ark of God's glory and God's presence. And Micah despised him. And the Bible said she bore him no children. Your attitude toward God will determine whether or not you are fruitful or barren. Your ability to move into His presence will open up the womb of your ministry and cause the purposes of God to be birthed in you, or it will shut you up. If you have become too dignified to take off your shoes and shout, if you have become too dignified to get on your face before God, if you have become too dignified to glorify His name, my friend, you have forgotten who it is you are worshiping. This is the God of gods and the King of kings and the Lord of glory, the Creator Himself. He's worthy of our praise. Worthy of our worship. Oh, glory to God. Now listen to me, church. Here is the word for tonight. The word is intimacy with God. Would you say it with me? The word is intimacy with God. God. Say it one more time. The word is intimacy with God. Now, pastors, listen to me. Some of us have been more in love with the bride of Christ, the church, than we have with Jesus. It is wrong to love another man's wife. And we have been committing spiritual adultery, thinking that if we loved His church, it was the same as loving Him, and it is not. We have said to our family, God first, church second, honey, you third, and the kids after that. It's wrong. It's not only adultery, it's idolatry. Love the church and the church will love you back. Take care of the church and the church will take care of you. Be kind to the church and the church will be kind to you. Be good to the system and the system will be good to you. And there are pastors here tonight that are angry and they're bitter because you have been asking the church to do for you what only Jesus Christ can do for you. And in a subtle kind of way, your focus has shifted from the Lord Jesus Himself to the church, and you've lost your passion for Jesus, and you're not walking in joy, and you're not walking in peace, and you're not walking in freshness, and you're not walking in hope, because you think the church has done you wrong. My friend, an imperfect church with imperfect people will never be to you what the perfect Christ must be to you. You have your passion in the wrong place. I am to love Christ and serve His church. Somebody said, I'll die for the church. You don't have to do that. He's already done that. Now you may have to die for Him, but you're not going to have to die for His church. I'm telling you, if there's anything God is telling us today, it is to stop church business and come back to Him. Let me tell you something. He's grieved How would you feel if your best friend was in love with your wife or your husband more than in love with you? Let me tell you something. He's hungry for us to have a relationship with him. Let's come back to Jesus. Let's let the church be the church. Let's stop asking the church to be Jesus, and let's get intimate with God. Let's come in and let him embrace us and let him love us. Let's find our first love again. Let's go back to the way it was when he washed us and made us clean and sanctified us and filled us with the blessed Holy Ghost. She said, number two, she said, the king hath brought me into his chambers. Now, this is the private chambers of the king. Using tabernacle terminology, this is the most holy place. I've been in the most holy place with him. I've been in the private, secret quarters with Jesus. When I was just a little kid, preschool, my grandmother kept my sister and I. She was a godly woman. I'll never forget one day, I don't know what was troubling her, but I remember her taking us both by the hand. She put me on one bed and my sister on another. And then she went into that little added-on room, that bathroom. Not for usual reasons. She went in to meet with God. She clicked that lock. I'll never forget the click of that lock. It was as if she was locking herself in that place with God. The strangest sounds commenced out of that room. Groanings, sounds like I had never heard. They were human, and yet they didn't have a normal quality about them. I have no idea how long I was on that cot. I didn't move. It was as if I could not have articulated it as a child. But now I look back and realize that profoundly impacted me. I was sitting there. I could not have felt any closer to God than if I had been up against the veil and the high priest had been in the most holy place. There was a presence exuding out of that room. There was something coming out of that room that even as a preschooler, I understood there is something happening here that my mind cannot understand. There is more than me and my sister and my grandma here. There's something else going on in this place. If you have been in the most holy place with him and you've been in the presence of the king, you know exactly what I'm talking about tonight. She came out of that room. She never looked at either of us. Her face was shining, glistening, wet with tears. And she went back to her kitchen and continued to groan and pray in the spirit. Groan and pray in the spirit. My goodness, that's over 40 years ago. And that still impacts me. If you are going to have a relationship with God, there have to be times when you go beyond the outer court and you go beyond the inner court and you go into the most holy place and you have a personal encounter with God where you know that you know deep down in your own knower that there is a God. And when you have that encounter, nobody will ever be able to take that away from you. I want to show you the third place. She said, where? Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 7. Where will you make your flock to rest at noon? Notice what she's saying here. She's saying, I want to know where I can meet you later today. I want to know where you're going to be later today. Listen to what she's saying. She's saying, I don't want the whole day to go by without having another encounter with you. I'm hungry for you. I want to spend time with you. Let me ask you something. Do you plan encounters with God during the day? Do you find moments where you can steal away into His presence? Do you, at the beginning of the day on the way to work, say, God, is there a possibility that you and I could meet for lunch today? Is there somewhere where we could steal away? God, you know that back place in the workroom. If I go back there, would you meet me there and refresh me with your presence? I don't think I can go all day without you. I'm hungry for you. I want to know where you're going to have lunch today because I'm going to go there. You remember when you were in love and you wanted to find, if you could go and meet your lover, you'd find a way to go. Oh, that's the kind of passion we need in the church today. I'm hungry for Him. God, where can I meet you today? I can't go all day without seeing you. Where can I meet you today? I want to meet you somewhere this afternoon, and I want us just to talk together. I want us to fellowship together. There's a fourth place. While the king sitteth at his table. I have been intimate with him. I've been in the most holy place. I have planned encounters with him. I schedule moments with God. And then I have been at his table. In the tabernacle, the table was where you had bread. How many cakes of bread were on that table? Anybody know? 12. How many sons of Jacob were there? 12. What's the significance? There's bread for every son and daughter of God on God's table. I want to tell you something tonight. God has bread for you on His table. Look at your neighbor and say, God has bread for you on His. He's got a loaf just for you. He has set bread on the table just for you. There's bread on the table for you. The Father put it out. He doesn't want you to go hungry here tonight. On the road to Emmaus, you remember? They were sad. And He came along beside them. And He said, why are you so sad? They said, didn't you read USA Today? See CNN this morning? That's a liberal translation. They said, no. They said, the one that we thought would be the Messiah to deliver Israel, he was crucified and put to death. Sad. We're depressed. We're having a pity party. The Bible said He opened up the Scriptures and revealed the Scriptures to them. He showed them a way of seeing the Old Testament they had never seen before. They said, we've got to turn in here. Have you got a place to stay? No. Why don't you turn in with us? Why don't you have a meal with us? He said, oh, I'd love to. And they sat at the, where? At the table. Say table. They sat at the table. And the Bible said, in the breaking of the bread, was He what? Was He revealed to them? I said, in the breaking of the bread was He revealed to them. I said, in the breaking of the bread was He revealed to him. You want to have intimacy with God? Then you go to the table and break the bread. And when you break the bread, He'll rise up out of the pages of the book, and it'll come alive, and He'll speak to you, and He'll feed you, and He'll touch you, and He'll give you strength. Oh, glory to God. They said, my, did our heart not burn within us? And we didn't want any Rolaids. Holy heartburn. There's a fifth place. He hath brought me to the banqueting house, and His banner over me was love. Now this is literally the house of wine. This is not the table. You would have dinner, and then you would go, listen, then you would go to an afterglow room and have wine. Welch's grape juice. Sure, that's what it is, don't you think, Brother Henson? No doubt about it. Now listen to me. Notice, there is the table, listen, there is the table, and then there is the afterglow, listen, in the house of wine, or let's call it a different term, in the house of the Holy Spirit. That's what we've been doing for years. We have the preaching of the word at the table, and then we come to the house of the Holy Spirit and just absolutely get intoxicated in the presence of God, and we just linger in the afterglow of His presence. Now, one of our problems is that we have become now a generation of fast food Pentecostals. You know, when I was a kid, we didn't have air conditioning, we didn't have carpeted floors, and we didn't have cushioned pews. We had old pine pews that were homemade, and you sat on them and they stuck to you. All your clothes had yellow streaks from about your shoulder blades to you know where. There are many, many times my mother and my grandparents insisted that they were called to turn the lights out at the church. If anybody wanted anything from God, they insisted on staying until they got what they wanted. And in those days, you came to church to pray till you prayed through. You heard the word, and then you went to the altar, and you lingered in the altar, and you stayed in the altar. Now, we didn't have a car, so they said, son, just go find you a place to sleep on one of those wonderful, comfortable pine pews under the window so that you can get the cross breeze. I hear people today saying, well, my kids have got to go to school tomorrow, and I just don't want them to be asleep in school, so if the service is going to go beyond 8 o'clock or 8:30, I've got to get them out of here. Let me tell you something, friend. I am so glad my parents, I'm so glad my grandparents didn't insist on getting me home so I could go to the Philistine school the next day. I am so glad I got to stay and hear the sounds of praise and prayer and worship in the house of God. There are sounds in my mind that I'll never be able to get out of saints praying around that altar, and I will be forever grateful for the itching of the Holy Ghost on the inner lining of my soul because the saints of God were in the house of wine. Oh, glory to God. Now, what have I said to you? I've said, number one, we need an intoxicating passion. I've said, number two, we need intimacy with Him in the most holy place. I've said, number three, that we need scheduled, disciplined times with Him on a daily basis. I've said, number three, if you want to be intimate with Him, it involves breaking bread at His table. And I've said, number five, you must not only break bread at the table, but you must linger in the house of wine until He stretches the banner of love over you and you know everything is gonna be all right. I'm talking about intimacy with God, and I'm telling you, your relationship with the church and your work in the church cannot take the place of your personal relationship with God through Christ by the Holy Spirit. Now, that's my introduction. Now, there are three movements in this passage I want to touch very quickly. Number one, you see it in chapter 2, verse 8. The voice of my beloved, behold, he comes leaping upon the mountain, skipping upon the hills. Now notice how the beloved pursues the maiden. Now this is a picture of how God in Christ pursues you. Do you know what a unique faith this is? There is no other faith like Christianity. No other faith where we have a seeking God. Every other faith, God is sought and He is elusive, and you never know if you contact Him or if He has heard you or not. But in this faith, He leaps over the mountains. You feel like there are mountains that are separating you and God. You don't have to move them. He's going to move them. He'll jump over that mountain to get to you. He cares about you. He loves you. No mountain is going to stand between you and Him. He puts it behind Him. He doesn't trudge over the mountains. He doesn't wearily climb the mountains. He skips, hops, leaps over the mountains. And as He comes, He calls. Where are you? I'm looking for you. Are you there? Hey, where are you? I'm looking. I'm coming. I'm coming to you. Oh, what a wonderful God we have. He wants intimacy with you more than you want intimacy with Him. The Bible says He leaps over the mountains. Then look at verse 9. He stands behind our wall and He's looking forth at the windows and showing Himself through the lattice. Now this is fascinating to me. He has leaped over mountains. The only thing separating Him and the beloved is a thin, flimsy layer of lattice. But He will not take it down. In the mystery of His sovereign ways, He will reach through the universe right down to where you are, and then He will grant you the wonderful privilege of limited sovereignty yourself, and you must exercise your free will and take down the final barrier and let Him in. He will come right to you, and then He'll say, would you take down this thing? Now you alone know what it is that keeps Him out. You alone know what it is that you have to put away. You alone know what that final barrier is. You alone know what that distraction is that keeps you from being intimate with Him. And He begs you tonight, take down that final wall and let Me into where you are. Notice there's a wonderful movement in this passage. He says, the winter is past, the rain is gone, the flowers appear, the singing of the birds is come, the fig tree is putting forth her green figs. The voice of the dove, the Holy Spirit, is heard in the land. Do you know what this is saying? It is, listen to me very carefully. Stay with me now. Stay with me now. Listen to me very carefully. This is saying your season is changing. Listen to me, church. We are going now into a seasonal change. We are about to come into another season that we have not been in before. more. There are some of you who feel like you have been in a winter. Here's what His word is to you. Get ready. We are coming into another season. Get out of your shell. Come out of that hole. Come on out here. It's springtime. The flowers are appearing. You can hear the voice of the dove, the Holy Ghost in the land. He's moving. There's a fresh wave of revival on. There's a fresh move of the Holy Ghost on. It's spiritual springtime. There are grapes already on the vine. There is a harvest that is coming in. We're coming in to a new season. Movement number two. By night on the bed I sought Him whom my soul loves. I sought Him, but I found Him not. Here's what she says. I rolled over in the night, and He wasn't there. I felt for Him, but He was gone. While I slumbered, He slipped away. She calls out, "Are you here? Are you in the house?" There's no answer. She may have been tempted to stay in the cozy comfort of the bed for a moment, but something deep inside stirs her. Listen carefully, church. Listen carefully. She gets up and she gets dressed. Here's what she said. I will rise and I will go about the city in the streets and I will seek Him that my soul loves. Listen to what she's saying. Listen to what she's saying. I can't get Him off my mind. I can't sleep not knowing where He is. I can't stand having lost His presence. Listen, I will not stay in a house where He is not present. I will not be satisfied with His house if He is gone. I'm not gonna just have His house and be okay with the memory of where He used to be. I want Him. And if He's not in the house, I'm not staying in this house. Let me tell you something. We've got people who are happy with His house without Him. Don't move that piano, my grandma played it. Don't touch that desk. I remember when my mama counted pennies from the penny marks when we were starting our hymn singing. Don't move that pulpit. That's the pulpit where the preacher leaned over and cried, gave the message in tongues when my daddy got saved. I don't want one in plexiglass, but I want that pulpit right there. We have a museum that we're visiting that has memories of His presence. I don't want His house if He's not here. I want Him. I want Him. I want Him. I'm not talking denomination. I'm not talking church. I'm talking Jesus. I'm talking Jesus. I'm talking Jesus. I get around preachers and all they can talk is politics. I get around preachers and church members and all they can talk about is numbers this. I'm hungry to be around people that are talking about Jesus. They want to know about Jesus. I'm hungry for Jesus. She said, I'm going to get up. I'm going to go find Him. She found the watchman. Do you know where He is? They were supposed to know. They're watching the city and they're watching Him. But they don't know where He is either. We've got churches without his presence, and we've got preachers that don't know what's happening and what God is up to and what God is doing in the earth, and they're not in touch with a fresh move of God, and we're in trouble when we're in this kind of condition. Oh God, I'm hungry for Jesus. Now there's one more movement and then I'm finished. Can you hang on with me? Then we'll take a coffee break and then we'll come back for the afterglow, the house of wine. Chapter 5, verse 2. I sleep, but my heart is awake. I love that. My body is resting, but my spirit is racing for another encounter with God. My spirit man is hungry to rise up and move into his presence again. Notice what happens. She says, it's him. It's him. It's the voice of my beloved. Where is he? He's at the door. I wanted to have an encounter with him, and there he is. What does he say? Open to me. Open to me, by my beloved. My hair is wet with dew. The air is cold and moist. Open to me. She says, I've already put off my shoes. I'm already in the bed. You see, there is a price that has to be paid for intimacy with God. Have you ever had that time when you were settled and suddenly in the night you were wide awake and the Holy Spirit hovered at your bed and Jesus said to you, come away with me, my beloved. Come to a quiet place. Come sit on the porch and let's talk for a while. Come away with me, my beloved. Have you ever had that time when he's come to see you in the middle of an afternoon at work and it's slow and he says, why don't you just drop everything? Let's run away, love. Let's run through the fields together. Let's just walk for a while. Let me whisper. Let me tell you that I love you. Oh, he's hungry to have an encounter with you. But there is a price that must be paid if you are going to be intimate with God. She waits, and when she gets up, he's gone. Listen, her hesitation cost her an encounter with God. Church, I would have disputed this a few years ago, but I'm absolutely convinced there are kairos moments when God visits a church and it is a window, an opportunity. And if we miss it, it doesn't come again, sometime for weeks, sometimes for years. There are times that God will visit you and he will say, I'm about to take you to the next level. And if you miss that moment, you may not have that chance again. Let me tell you something. This is not a king to be played with. This is not a king you can put on a leash. This is the sovereign God who loves you and tenderly comes to you. You can't treat him like a little puppy dog and say, you wait on me until I get in my comfort zone or until Bonanza goes off. If he calls, you've got to drop everything and say, I'm coming, I'm moving into your presence. Nothing is more important than you. I got to stop. The Bible says when Zion travails, she will bring forth. Anybody believe in visions? 17 of us. It's encouraging. I didn't believe in visions until God started giving them to me. Then my theology changed. About 10 years ago, standing on an altar, I had not preached that night, I saw a vision. I saw a vision of a man on his knees with his head between his knees. Now, that's the ancient Near Eastern birthing posture. And I knew immediately that this man was in travail. He was groaning and praying, and God was trying to birth something through him. Groaning, agonizing, like a woman in labor, praying. He was in a spotlight with as clear and definitive a perimeter as if you were to shine a spotlight on a totally black stage. And I could see nothing but him and darkness on every side. And as he continued to pray, I saw in the middle heaven a demon, a strong man. And the more that man prayed, the angrier that demon became. He began to make guttural sounds, drool, angrily focused on that man. I knew he was about to attack that prayer warrior. Suddenly, out of the third heaven, an arm, like a grandpa's arm, reached down with chains and began to wrap that demonic prince up. And God spoke to my spirit and said, "If my people will pray, I will bind the strong man over their city." Now, church, listen to me. I am not against spiritual warfare. I understand the principle of spiritual warfare. But the book of Ecclesiastes says wisdom is better than war. I am not into spiritual warfare. I am into the harvest and the consummation of the purposes of God in a time-space world. Now, I understand that that puts me at cross purposes with the devil, and therefore there are going to be occasions where I may have skirmishes with him, but I want to use my energy as much as possible in consummating the purposes of God and not in warfare. Wisdom is better than warfare. If we will pray, God will bind the strong man and give us liberty and space to reap the harvest. Suddenly, it was as if light shot in every direction as far as I could see. And where there was nothing but darkness, suddenly I saw tens of thousands of people on every hand who had been chained and held by nothing but the darkness. The God of this world hath blinded their minds. But that man's prayer pulled the blinders off and pushed the darkness back. And suddenly, like a herd of animals, people started running into the light from every direction. And God said to me again, "Pray, not only will I bind the strong man, I will bring them in from the north, the south, the east, and the west. I'll bring the harvest in to the light." Now I want to ask you a question. Does travail produce the child? No.
Intimacy produces the child. And travail delivers it. There are some people who are acting pregnant and they ain't pregnant. You will never give birth to the purposes of God for your life until you are intimate with Him. And when you are intimate with Him, He will put in you purposes and dreams and plans beyond your imagination. You'll have to have the discipline to carry them to term. It'll hurt you. It'll be back-breaking. It'll be muscle-stretching. It'll be difficult. And some of us have miscarried the purposes of God over and over and over again. But the good news is, if you'll go back to Him again and have another intimate encounter, He will fill you up with the life of His purposes, and He'll give you the grace, and there'll come a day, a season, when you'll begin to give birth to the purposes of God for your life. You'll have that church. You'll have that breakthrough. You'll have that revival. You'll see that healing. You'll see that breakthrough. Oh, glory to God. The word is intimacy. Are you just in love with His wife? Have you been asking His wife to do for you what only He can do for you? Are you bitter because the church hasn't made you happy? Your passion is in the wrong place. Serve His church. Filled with imperfect people, put your passion in your relationship with Him. He'll never disappoint you. He'll never let you down. Stand all over this place. I have a simple invitation. I'm looking for preachers that are hungry, not for a revival, because let me tell you something, the gateway to revival is where? In where? In Jesus. I'm looking for preachers that are hungry for Jesus. And you're willing to say here tonight, I want to be intimate with Him. I don't want you to wait a moment. I want you to get out of your seat, and I want you to come to this altar, and I want you to find a place, and I want you to tell Him, I want you. I need you. I'm hungry for you. Get on your face if you need to. I want us to wait in the house of the Holy Spirit, in the house of wine, until we get full of Him, freshly intoxicated on Him. His presence. Oh, rasende bore, frose pero bore kelebo, shende le bore si frobo, oh, rasende borande lebeke, coro sepe orebe, sende rondo bele corebe si fro, sente lebe si. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Now, here's what else I'm looking for. If you are in this house and you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, or you want a fresh encounter with God, and you, I want you to move to the closest aisle next to you. Get out of the aisle, get into the aisle.
If you're here tonight and you're a layman and you're saying, I want a fresh encounter with God, get in the aisle right next to you. Come on, layman. These preachers are not the only one, I hope, that are hungry for God. I'm hungry for God. Get in the aisle next to you. Come on, layman. Move with me. Get in the aisle. Just move right out in that aisle. I'm hungry for God. Get right out in that aisle. I'm hungry for God. I'm hungry for God. Come on. Come on. I'm hungry for God. I want to be intimate with God. Come on. Get out into the aisle. Out into the aisle. Get as close to the front as you can. Get as close to the front as you can. Get as close to the front as you can. And I want some of the rest of you in this place to do one of two things. I want you to reach out in that aisle and start praying for people standing in that aisle, or I want you to make a group of two or three, turn around and make a group and pray one with another. I want everybody in this building praying. Everybody in this building praying. Turn around. Make a group. Make a group. Form a little group and pray one for another. Everybody in this house seeking God. Everybody in this house saying, God, I want to be intimate with you. I want a fresh encounter with you.